Hello and welcome to lecture 11. In this lecture we will look at a few more involved theorems. Before I go into the theorem, I will introduce the notion of a graph of a circuit. So if you have some circuit, each of these could be any elements, we don't make any distinctions between them at this level. A graph of this is basically a picture that contains a node for every node of the circuit, and the elements are simply represented as branches. This is basically an abstract representation of a circuit and is useful for discussing some very general properties of a circuit. Okay, so this is the graph of this circuit. Okay, now let's say we take two different circuits. Okay, this is circuit 1 and I have another circuit. It could have any element. Okay, you see that both circuits have 4 nodes and both circuits have elements between corresponding nodes, the same corresponding nodes. Okay, in the first circuit I have an element between 1 and 2, in the second one also between 1 and 2, and so on. And it's also clear that both of these circuits have the same graph. So a graph representation is not useful for discussing particular properties of some circuit, but for general properties of all circuits sharing certain graphs. Okay, so with this short introduction, let's move on. So first let me take a circuit. In fact, I'll take the same kind of circuit I had before. Okay, I have all these branches, and as I mentioned earlier, this circuit has this particular graph. Okay, and let me number the branches like this: 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and for each of them I will show the voltage across the branch: V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, and V6. And I'll also show the currents with the passive sign convention. That is, I will take the current as entering that terminal of the element whose voltage is defined to be positive. Okay, so for instance, V6 is defined like this. So I'll take I6 in that direction, I1 this way, I5, I2, I4, and I3. Okay, and first what I want to look at is basically some of the products of voltage and current over all branches. I introduced this expression in the previous class, but now we'll examine it and see what it comes out to and evaluate it exactly. Okay, so first I will do it for this graph, but I will quickly illustrate that it's not true for this particular graph. This will be true for every circuit. Okay, so now what I will first do is I will represent every voltage as difference between node voltages with respect to some reference node. Okay, so let me take this as the reference node. If I call these nodes A, B and C. Okay, so clearly I can write, first I'll expand these things. It is V1 I1 plus V2 I2 plus V3 I3 plus V4 I4 plus V5 I5 plus V6 I6. And this whole thing equals, you can clearly see from Kirchhoff's voltage law that V1 equals VA minus the reference node voltage, which is by definition 0. So V1 equals VA, V2 equals VA minus VB, V3 equals VB, and so on. So if I complete these for every one of them, I'll have VA times I1 plus VA minus VB times I2 plus VB times I3 plus VB minus VC times I4 plus VC times I5 plus VA minus VC times I6. Okay. And finally, first I had this form where I summed V and I over all branches. You know that VK IK is the power dissipated in the kth branch at that particular instant of time. Okay. Now, we don't worry about whether VK and IK are time varying or constant or what kind of elements we have. Okay. But at every instant of time, the circuit will obey Kirchhoff's current law and Kirchhoff's voltage law. So we can take this product, some of these products, and decompose them like this and turn it into a form like this. Then, instead of having a summation over all branches, I will now group the node voltages together. So VA, I have it here, here and here. Okay. And how many terms will I have? 3, because there are 3 branches connected to node A. Okay. And what is multiplying VA? It is I1 plus I2 plus I6. Okay, and similarly VB, there are 3 branches connected to node B, so I expect 3 terms, and indeed there are 3 of them here, here and here. Okay, and I'll have minus I2 plus I3 plus I4. Okay, and finally VC, again 3 branches connected to node C, so we'll have 1, 2 and 3 occurrences of VC. I'll have minus I4 plus I5 minus I6. And if I look at each of these terms, what is I1 plus I2 plus I6? It's simply the total current leaving node A. Okay, and obviously by Kirchhoff's current law, this whole thing equals 0. Similarly, minus I2 plus I3 plus I4 is nothing but the total current leaving node B. Okay, I2 is entering node B, so we have minus I2, and I3 and I4 are leaving node B, so we have plus I3 plus I4. Okay, so this sum also equals 0, and similarly, minus I4 plus I5 plus I6, sorry, minus I6, minus I4 plus I5 minus I6 will be 0, because that is the total current leaving node C. Okay, so obviously the entire product will be equal to 0. So though I did it for this particular circuit, I can show that it is true for a general circuit. What did I do? I took summation of VK times IK, where K basically runs over all the branches of the circuit. Then I represent each voltage as the difference between two node voltages. This is always possible. It could be that the second node voltage could be is 0. That is, if some branch is connected to the reference node, then one of these voltages will simply be the reference node. But obviously any branch voltage equals the difference between the voltage at one terminal and voltage at the other terminal, where Vp and Vn are measured with respect to the reference node. Now, if either of these two nodes itself happens to be the reference node, then Vp or Vn will be equal to 0. But this description holds in any case. So, I can sum over all branches with this modified form. Then, what I'll do is, I'll convert this into a summation over all nodes. So, let me call this J, where J runs over all nodes, okay, Vj, and that will be multiplying some terms containing currents, okay. So, now the way we define the voltages, if you have a branch K whose voltage is Vk, then the current Ik goes this way. It goes from the plus terminal, where as Vk is defined, to the minus terminal. Okay, we use the passive sign convention. So, whichever node is the positive terminal, that is this Vp, it will get multiplied by plus Ik. Okay, and Vn will get multiplied by minus Ik. This Ik is simply flowing from this node P to this node N. Let me name these nodes P and N. Okay. So, if a current is leaving a node, then it will have a positive sign, that is, we have Vp times Ik with a positive sign, and if the current is entering a node, then we will have a negative sign. I will have minus Vn times Ik. Okay. So, I will have sum of currents multiplying this, and basically this will be nothing but sum of currents leaving the node when I collect all the terms, because I will have currents leaving this node with a positive sign, and there could be some other branch and currents entering this node that will have a negative sign. So, basically if I change this to summing over all the nodes, then the node voltage Vj will be multiplied by something, and that something is sum of currents leaving the node, okay, which by Kirchhoff's current law equals 0. So, every node voltage gets multiplied by 0, which means that summation of Vkik over all branches equals 0, okay, and this is nothing but a statement of the conservation of power, okay, and with this we will prove even more interesting results about circuits, and finally also come to reciprocity theorem, which is quite useful when we have circuits with an input and output port, that is two port networks, okay. Now, let's say I have this network N and network N hat, which have exactly the same graph. Of course, the elements may not have anything to do with each other, okay. Yeah, and of course, as usual, we have not yet used linearity or anything. So, it could be nonlinear also, right. I could, for instance, in the first, in the network N, the branch one could be a voltage source, in the other one it could be a resistor or a diode or whatever it is, okay. All that is possible. And I will denote voltages and currents in this by Vk and Ik, and in this by Vk hat and Ik hat. Okay? Clearly, from what we just now said, sum of Vk Ik over all branches, I will just say over K, that means K running through all the branches, is 0. And here, what would it be?
VK hat, IK hat would be 0. Okay, is this fine? Okay, fine. Now, let me show it a little bigger with some boxes for elements. This the same graph, right? So, and this is n and n hat. Okay, and let's say in the network n hat I have currents I1. Let me show that in a different color. I1, I2, I3, I4, I5, I6. Okay, these are the currents that are flowing in the network. And that what exactly they are depends on what elements there are in the circuit. But let's not worry about that. What I'll do is I will take a current source whose value is the first branch current, whose value is I1, okay, and connect it across this branch. Okay, so actually let me not abuse notation, these are hatted quantities, I1 hat, I2 hat and so on up to I6 hat. So what I will do is I will connect, take I1 hat, that is I will look at the network N hat, I will look at whatever current is flowing in branch 1, I will make a current source equal to that value and connect that current source across branch 1 of network N. Okay, and similarly I do it for all branches. Okay. Now let's say originally the branch voltages and currents in this circuit N were VK and IK that you got by solving for this circuit. Now after I connect these current sources, what will be the solutions? No, no, I am talking about currents in these black elements. Okay, voltages. Okay, what will be the branch voltages in this circuit, in the new circuit? Superposition of those two? Okay, so you are saying the branch voltages will get added up and currents will get added up. Why?
Voltages will remain same, current will subtract.
What is superposition? No, no, superposition, I mean please understand what is superposition. Superposition is you have a network and you disable some sources in it and you disable some other sources, you add up the solutions individually, that will be the final solution with all the sources active. But here that's not what I have done, I have changed the network, right? I originally had the only the black elements here, to that I have added these blue current sources. Now these blue current sources are not arbitrary, I took another circuit with the same graph, I copied the current values from that into this. Okay, so tell me what will be the branch voltages in this? VK, VK hat, why? Remains the same, why? I mean, if we connect something in parallel, things won't remain the same, right? Now, how would you go about solving for this? First of all, let's say I didn't have these current sources, I had the black network, okay? How would I go and solve for this one? What method would I use? Nodal analysis, okay. Now, after I add the current sources, what happens to the nodal analysis equations? source vector will change. How will it change? By how much will it change? What's that? No change. Why? See, I have not taken arbitrary currents here. It is true. To each node I have added some current. But what are those currents? The sum of those currents added are also zero because it comes from another circuit which is valid, which follows KCL. Okay. For instance, if you think of the original nodal equations at, let's say, node N1, I will show it only for this. You would say these black current I1 plus I2 plus I6 would be 0. Okay. Now, what else do you have? Would be equal to the currents flowing into, this will get changed to minus I1 hat plus I2 hat plus I6 hat, which is also 0. Okay. So, if you, let's say you think of the methodology of solving this circuit by writing down nodal analysis equations, you see that at every node the equation doesn't change at all because the net current added to every node is 0, right? Because I have not added a single current, I have added all the currents by copying it from some other circuit with the same graph. So, at every node, if you compute the sum of the blue current sources in the appropriate direction, it will be 0. Okay, that means that the nodal analysis equations will remain exactly the same as before. So, what are the branch voltages now? Same as before, Vk. Okay, is that fine? Now, I can think of this entire thing as a branch, right? That's possible. I mean, my two terminal element could consist of my original branch plus this current source in parallel. Okay. What will be the, so first of all, and what will be the branch current through the blank black branches alone? Same as before, IK. So now with this new branch, which is the parallel combination of the old branch and the current source in parallel with it, what is the total current? Sum of the two, IK plus IK hat. Okay, please follow the reasoning carefully. This looks very simple, but just follow the steps logically. Okay, these branches are have currents IK plus IK hat. Okay, now this is a third circuit with the same graph. Okay, now each branch will be the original branch in the black circuit plus the current source which is copied from the second circuit, the hatted circuit. Okay, but this is also a graph with the, I mean, this is also a circuit with the same graph. And if you apply this to the new circuit, what will you get? What did we say for every circuit? Sum of Vk, sum of branch products of branch voltages and branch currents equals 0. Okay. Now I can do this to the new combined circuit, isn't it? I have to do it for the branch voltage here, which is V1, and the branch current here, which is I1. Okay, maybe I will call it some I1 dash or something and V1 dash. So, what is the result? Sum of V1 dash, I1 dash will also be 0. Okay. And what is, sum of Vk dash, Ik dash, not V1 dash, I1 dash. And what is Vk dash? Vk. The original circuit, original solution to the network N. And what is IK dash? IK plus IK hat equals 0. So, VK, IK plus VK, IK hat equals 0. Vk ik plus Vk ik hat equals 0. Okay, what next? First term we already know is 0. Okay, so Vk ik, this was 0. So we have sum of Vk ik hat equals 0. Okay, now this is, I mean, please understand the significance of this result. And we have not used anything other than to say that the circuit obeys KCL and KVL. You have two circuits completely unrelated except that they have the same graph. So, you take the voltages, branch voltages from circuit 1 and corresponding branch currents from circuit 2, form this current times voltage products and sum them, that will also be equal to 0. okay, and this is just a consequence of the circuit having obeyed KCL and KVL. Okay, this VK times IK hat, that number doesn't have any meaning for the same, I mean in this, if you take VK and IK from the same circuit, that will be the power dissipated in that branch. Okay, otherwise it has no meaning at all, because in fact the elements also could be completely different. This here, the kth branch could be a voltage source, there it's a current source and so on. Okay, but this theorem is true. Is this fine? What we did was we took two circuits which had the same graph, then we formed a third circuit which was circuit number 1 plus current sources copied from circuit number 2, and we did that for every branch. That is very important, otherwise it won't be true. Okay, and now you get a third circuit whose branch voltages remain the same, branch currents are the sum of currents in the first two circuits, and for that also this branch voltage times branch current product will be 0. Okay, from that we get this very interesting result that you take two circuits with the same graph, you take the voltage from this, current from that, form products, sum them over all branches, that will also be equal to 0. Okay, any questions? What do you think of the product sum of VK hat IK? 0. How would you go about proving that? You could take the currents from the first circuit, put it into the added circuit. Okay, so that is also 0. Now again, this is consequence of only KCL and KVL, so it can include the elements that we have not considered so far, right? Anything that obeys KCL and KVL, it will work. It will also work for capacitors and inductors and so on. Okay. Now, also this network N and N prime need not be two separate circuits. Okay, it can be the same circuit at time 1 and time 2, right? So it is also true that in the same circuit VK at T1 and IK at some T2, this will also be 0. You can just think of it as, you have two different cases where KCL and KVL are obeyed. And of course, it is also true that if you have the voltages from the first network at a time T1 and currents from the second network at a time T2, this will also be equal to, VK. I am saying I can take the voltages from the first circuit at time T1 and current from the second circuit at a different time. That is also true, right? I mean, that's yet another case that has the same graph and obeys KCL and KVL. That's all. Okay? And this result is also true for any, we are of course used to circuits, but anything where these laws are obeyed, that is the sum of flow from a node is 0. Okay, the total sum of the total flow from a node will be equal to 0. And also if you go around the loop, the sum of branch variables, the across variables will be 0. Okay. Now for us, the across variable is the voltage and the through variable is the current. But it works for many other things also, like fluid flow and things like that. Okay. And this extremely interesting result is known as Telegen's theorem, named after the person who first proved it. Okay. Again, the way we have gone about proving that is very simple, but you have to be conversant enough with KCL and KVL to follow the logic correctly. Now, this theorem itself is rather too general. Okay, in fact, it's I would say in some ways too general to be useful directly, because now we are talking about general properties of networks, whereas in this course our concern are some specific circuits. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll derive some specific results from this Telegen's theorem. Any questions so far about the proof or statement of Telegen's theorem? Now let me take a network N, okay, and this has, and this has only resistors, Okay, this is more, I mean, less general than before. We don't have control sources and we have only resistors in this. And let's say it has two pairs of terminals. Okay, to which we can, I mean, with only resistors, if you have only that, of course, all the solutions will be zero, all the currents will be zero and voltages will be zero. We have to connect sources somewhere, and let's say we have two pairs of terminals where we can do that. Okay. And let's say I have connected V1 here. Actually, yeah, let me say I have connected VA here and VB. The sources could be anything. It could be two current sources, two voltage sources, or one voltage and one current source. Okay, I am just showing the case of two voltage sources. And you have these currents I and IB. Okay. Now, let me first make VA equal to 0. That means I will short circuit this. And in the other case, I will make VB equal to 0. I will short circuit that one. Okay. Now, let me, in the first case, think of this one as the input and this IA as the result for the output. And similarly, in this case, I think of VA as the input. There is only one source, right? And IB as the output. And this is a very common view, right? You have some network, you connect something here, you look at the output there. Now, what do you think is the relationship? Let's say I connect 1 volt here and I will get some IA. If I apply 1 volt here, will I be able to tell what IB is? So, please write down the Telegen's theorem equations for this and then see what comes out. Okay. Now, you can think of these two circuits, right? And to avoid confusion, let me put hats on this. It's the same network N, but it's not the same I and IB that's flowing there, right? We don't know that. Okay. So, I have to put hats on these things. Okay. So, now I apply Telegen's theorem to this whole circuit and then see what comes out. Please do that. If I take the voltages from this and the currents from the second circuit and form the products and add them up, that will be 0. Okay. Similarly, voltages from the second one and the current from the first one, that will also be 0. Okay. Now, for a consistent polarity, I have to multiply VB with minus IB hat. Okay. Because I have to take the direction going in from top to bottom. Okay. So, first I will take, if I call this network N and N hat, the voltages from N and the currents from N hat. Okay. So, what is that? VB times minus IB hat plus the sum of all voltages inside this resistive network times currents in that hatted currents in the corresponding hatted currents in the resistive network plus the voltage across this, but that is 0. Okay. So, that I will ignore. Okay. This is over k branches inside the resistive network. Next, I will take the voltages from N hat and the currents from N. What will I get? What is the first term? VA hat times minus Ia, okay, because of the way we have defined the currents. Plus summation of Vk hat Ik over all branches equals 0. So far we have not used anything about it being a resistive network. So where will we use it? So Vk would be, Vk is the branch current times the branch resistance. Similarly, Vk hat is Ik hat times the branch resistance. Okay. So what will we get out of it? And I will use the resistive network part here. Okay. And similarly, in the other case, Va hat minus Ia plus K Vk hat Ik was 0. And if I use the fact that it is a resistive network, Va hat minus Ia plus K Rk Ik hat Ik equals 0. So what do you get from these results? So clearly this part is common to the two equations, right? So this has to be equal to that one, okay? I can of course now remove the minus signs. Now what is this? Va hat. This is the hat. Okay. Okay. Is this fine? So what is that saying about these cases? Yeah. Okay. So what is it saying about these two cases? I have a resistive network, that's all I know about it. Okay, it could have thousands of resistors, but there are two terminals exposed on this side and on that side. Okay. I apply 1 volt here, short circuit the other side. That is, I could apply voltage sources to both sides and then I set one of the voltage sources to 0. Then I measure the short circuit current, it will be something. Now if I apply 1 volt to the other side, measure the short circuit current here, what will it be? It's exactly the same, not merely proportional, it will be the same. Okay, it will of course be proportional because it's resistive network. But that's not what this is saying, right? What is the final result we got? Ia by Vb is Ib hat by Va hat. Isn't it? It's a very interesting result. If you have resistors alone, this is known as reciprocity theorem. The network is reciprocal. That is, if you apply some stimulus here, measure the effect there, and if you apply a stimulus on the other side, measure the effect here, they will be exactly the same. Okay, that is, the ratio of the response to stimulus will be the same. Okay, so please understand this theorem carefully.
We already proved the reciprocity theorem when we had voltages exciting from one side or the other side. Now there could be other cases, that is, you could have current sources from either side or voltage source from one side and current source from another side. I will not prove reciprocity theorem for all these cases, but you can follow the exact same steps as I did earlier and prove all of these as well. Okay. So just for completeness, let me take a resistive network with two ports, 1-1 prime and 2-2 prime. I have excited this side with V1, okay, and short circuited this side. I will measure the current I2, and in another case I have the same network N. Of course, that's very important. I excite this side with V2 hat and short circuit this side and measure I1 hat here, and reciprocity theorem. Says that I2 by V1 is exactly equal to I1 hat divided by V2 hat. Okay. Now let's look at the other cases. Again, a resistive network N. I excite it with a current source I1 and measure the voltage V2 here. Okay. In this case, the excitation or the cause is the current and the response or the effect is the voltage. I inject I2 hat from this side and V1 hat I obtain on the other side. And again, by reciprocity, it turns out that V2 by I1 exactly equals I2 hat by, sorry, V1 hat by I2 hat. That is, the ratio of response to excitation when port 1 is excited is exactly the same as the ratio of response to excitation when port 2 is excited. Now finally, we have the third case where again I have a resistive network N and I excite the first side, port 1, with a voltage and measure the voltage that comes out on this side. And in the other case, I take the exact same network N . I excite the second side with a current I2 hat and measure the current that flows in the first side. Please mind the directions of voltages and currents, otherwise you will end up with extra minus signs in different places. So reciprocity in this case says that V2 by V1, which is the response by excitation in the upper circuit, exactly equals minus I1 hat by I2 hat, which is the response by excitation in the lower circuit. Okay. You get this minus sign because of the direction of the current chosen. If we had chosen it outwards, we would have got a plus sign. But for consistency, we have taken all currents as flowing inwards into the resistive port. Okay. Now we have a last case that is left, which is trivial. That is exciting the left side by a current and right side by a voltage. That is simply flipping this picture sideways. So I am not going to discuss that. Okay. Now, I will show all of these things with an extremely simple circuit as an example. My resistive network is just this, has three resistors R1, R2 and R3, and let me connect first a voltage source to this side and I will short circuit the second side, and in the second case I will connect a voltage source V2 hat to the right side and short circuit the left side. I will measure the current I2 in this case and I1 hat in that case. So now it's very clear that because of the short circuit, this voltage simply appears across R2. Okay. So the voltage source is connected across R2. So the current in R2 is simply V1 divided by R2. Also, because of the short circuit, no current flows in R3, and is I2 simply equals minus V1 by R2. That's because of the directions chosen. V1 by R2 is flowing from left to right, whereas I2 is taken as from right to left. Okay, so I2 equals minus V1 by R2, or I2 by V1, which is response by excitation, equals minus 1 by R2. If you now look at the lower circuit, again because of the short circuit, this voltage V2 appears across R2, and therefore the current in R2 is V2 hat by R2, and again because of the short circuit no current flows through R1, and because of the way we have chosen the direction of I1 hat will be equal to minus V2 hat by R2. So which means that I1 hat by V2 hat is minus 1 by R2, minus 1 by R2. Okay. So this illustrates reciprocity. We have already proved it for the general case, but it's always a good idea to work out some real examples and convince yourselves that this is indeed the case. Now let me excite the circuit with currents instead of voltages. I'll excite it with I1 on the left side and measure the voltage V2 that's produced on the right side, and the other case I'll take the exact same network, excite it with a current on the right side and I2 hat and see the voltage that's produced on the left side. Okay. So now what is the voltage developed here? First of all, this I1 divides into two parts. One part goes through R1, the other one goes through the series combination of R2 and R3. And by results on current division, you know that the current that flows here is I1 times R1 divided by R1 plus R2 plus R3. Okay, and V2 is nothing but this current times the resistance R3. So this is equal to V2. The response by excitation V2 by I1 will be simply R1 R3 by R1 plus R2 plus R3. Okay. Now we can evaluate V1 hat in exactly the same way. This current I2 hat gets divided into two parts, one through R3, another one through R1 plus R2. Okay. So the part of the current that flows through R2 is given by I2 hat times R3 by R3 plus R1 plus R2. This is by current division theorem. And the voltage that is developed across R1 is nothing but this current, which we have evaluated here, times R1. So this times R1 is the voltage V1 hat. So the response for excitation V1 hat by I2 hat equals R1 R3 by R1 plus R2 plus R3, which is exactly the same as in this case. Okay, so we have exactly the same response by excitation in the two cases as we expected. And finally, let me illustrate it for a case where you have a voltage on one side and a current on the other side. I'm also illustrating this. The purpose of illustrating this is also that when you encounter such a situation, you apply reciprocity appropriately. Okay. So let me take V1 on this side and measure V2 on the right side, and in the other case I'll apply a current I2 hat on this side and measure the current I1 hat that flows over there. Okay. Now in the upper circuit, this V1 appears across the series combination of R2 and R3. We also have R1, but that is directly across the voltage source V1, so it has no effect. So V2 is simply V1 times the resistance divider ratio, which is R3 by R2 plus R3, or V2 by V1 is simply R3 by R2 plus R3. Okay. And in the other case, what happens? We have a short circuit on this side. So that means that no current flows through R1. Across that, we have a short circuit. So we just have two resistors, R3 and R2, in parallel with the current source. Okay. I hope all of you are able to see that. Otherwise, you can see that the terminals of the current sources are here, and terminals of R2 are exactly the same, and terminals of R3 are also exactly the same. That is, they are connected to the same nodes. Now the current divides between R3 and R2. The current flowing through R2 in this direction is given by I2 hat times R3 by R3 plus R2. This is from the current division theorem. Now all of it flows into this short circuit, but this current I1 hat is taken in the opposite direction. So the actual current I1 hat is minus I2 hat times R3 by R3 plus R2. Okay. Again, if we calculate the response by excitation, I1 hat by I2 hat equals minus R3 by R2 plus R3, and you can see that these two ratios of response by excitation are related by a factor -1, exactly as we expected. Okay. Now it turns out that this reciprocity theorem is very useful in many practical situations, and one such situation is where you have a number of sources in a circuit and you want to calculate the response at a given point, whether it is current or a voltage between two points. Okay. Now, instead of calculating the response from multiple sources, what you can do is use reciprocity, interchange the locations of the source and the response, and calculate all these responses to a single source, which is definitely easier. Okay. And by using reciprocity theorem, you can get all of the original responses that you wanted. It turns out this is very useful, and it is used in circuit simulators also, particularly for noise analysis, where you have noises from many parts of the circuit affecting your output. Okay. You've already seen the proof of reciprocity in resistive networks using Telegen's theorem. Here, what I'll show is an alternative proof using basic circuit analysis. Okay.
So what I'll do is I will consider a three terminal two port. This is port 1, port 2, and this is the common terminal, and the important thing is that this is resistive. Okay, now let's say, just for the sake of it, I will drive it with I1 on this side and I2 on that side. Okay, the reason to do this is pretty obvious. I would like to use nodal analysis for the analysis of this. Now we know that nodal analysis is most convenient when you have only resistors and independent current sources. Okay, now what I'll do is this network itself is quite arbitrary. There can be any number of nodes inside. So I will label this as node N1 and this as node N2, and inside there could be any more number of nodes, and I will call them N3 to N capital N. Okay, so there are a total of capital N nodes in the circuit. Now if you set up the nodal analysis equations for this, N1, N2, a number of rows up to N capital N. And remember, this is a purely resistive network and the only independent sources in the circuit are I1 and I2. Okay. So now I will have some G matrix. This is the conductance matrix times the variable vector V, which is V1, V2, where this is V1 with respect to the common terminal and the voltage here is V2, and after that you have V3 all the way to V capital N. Okay, and G times V, the unknown vector, equals the source vector, and the source vector consists only of two non-zero elements, I1 which is being injected into node N1 and I2 which is being injected into node N2, and the rest of it is 0. Okay. Now of course, because the network is purely resistive, this G matrix is symmetric. Okay. So let's say I have G11, G12 all the way to G1n here. Now the first element of the second row, first column and second row, will be also G12. Okay. G22, etc. G2n, and similarly here we have G13, G23 and so on. Okay. So this will be symmetric because we don't have any control sources in the circuit, the network is purely resistive. Okay. Now for reciprocity, basically I need to find the relationship between let's say V1 and I2 and V2 and I1. Okay. So what I'll do is I'll try to eliminate all the remaining variables. So for that, let me subdivide this matrix into four pieces. Okay. So there are four submatrices here, as you can clearly see. You have one and another one and another one here and yet another one there. Okay. So let me write that, let me write those things as GA and GB, GC and GD. Okay. Now clearly GA is just a 2 by 2 matrix. GB has 2 rows and n minus 2 columns. It is 2 times n minus 2. And GC is the complement of that, which is n minus 2 rows and 2 columns. And GD has n minus 2 rows and n minus 2 columns. Okay. And this times the variable vector V equals the source vector I. Okay. Now, because the G matrix is symmetric, we can tell a few things about this. First of all, GA will be a symmetric matrix. GD will also be a symmetric matrix. And also, If you look at GB and GC, GC is nothing but GB transpose. Okay. Now what I'll do is, this variable vector V, let me write it as V1, V2, and then the vector of the rest of them, which I'll simply call Vx. Okay, this itself is a vector. Vx has n minus 2 elements in it. Okay, and that will be equal to I1, I2, and all zeros here. Okay. Now I will write this as two separate equations. The first part corresponding to these two rows is GA times V1 V2 plus GB. Let me denote it like this to make it clear that these are matrices. GB times VX equals I1, I2. And for this part, I have GC times V1, V2 plus GD times VX equals vector of all zeros. Okay. So, what I will do is basically eliminate VX from these two equations. That's all. It's just like eliminating a variable from two linear equations, except that we have now vectors and matrices instead of scalar coefficients and scalar variables. Okay. So, but that doesn't pose any particular complication. Okay. So, if we call this 1 and 2, if I solve for Vx in the second one, it's clear that Vx will be GD inverse times minus GC times V1, V2. Okay. And I will use this N1. By the way, this means that GD has to be invertible, and we won't go into the complication. We'll assume that GD is invertible. Okay. Then what we have is, if we use this N1, it's pretty straightforward. We'll have GA minus GB times GD inverse times GC, this whole thing. Remember, this is a 2x2 matrix. V1, V2 equals I1, I2. Okay. Now, from this, it's pretty clear that this 2x2 matrix times V1, V2 equals I1. I2. Okay. So, if you think of this as a two port, this entire thing is the Y matrix of the two port. Right? Or the inverse of this would be the Z matrix of the two port. Okay. Because what is the Y matrix after all? Y times V1, V2 equals I1, I2. It's the matrix that relates the port voltages to port currents. Okay. So now let's examine the Y matrix of this. The Y matrix of our two port is GA minus GB GD inverse GC Okay. So first of all, we know that GC is GB transpose. Okay. So this is equal to GA minus GB GD inverse and GB transpose. So first of all, GA itself is symmetric, that we knew earlier, we discussed that. And if you look at this part, we have GB GD inverse and GB transpose. And to check for symmetry, obviously you just take the transpose of this. What will you get? If you have three matrices A, B, C transpose, you know that basically this is C transpose times B transpose times A transpose. Okay. So if you transpose this, what you will get is GB transpose transpose, that is corresponding to this one, times GD inverse and transposed, and finally GB transpose. This comes from here. Okay. And clearly this is equal to GB GD inverse transpose. Remember, GD itself was symmetric, therefore GD inverse is symmetric. So GD inverse transpose is the same as GD inverse, and finally GB transpose. So the transpose of the matrix is the same as the matrix itself. So this is also symmetric. This was symmetric. We knew this earlier. And from these two, clearly, if you subtract one symmetric matrix from another, you will get yet another symmetric matrix. Okay. So what this shows is that this Y matrix is symmetric, which means Y21 is Y12. Therefore, our resistive two port is reciprocal. Okay. Reciprocity means that Y12 equals Y21. So instead of starting from Telegen's theorem and getting these results, we could also do it by defining a two port, and we have some two port parameters. We try to calculate the two port parameters from basic circuit analysis, in this case nodal analysis, and you can find that the Y matrix happens to be symmetrical. Of course, if you find any one parameter set to be symmetrical, the rest of them follow the same symmetry. Now the Z matrix will also be symmetrical, and if you look at G or H parameters, G12 will be minus G21, or H12 will be minus H21, and so on. Okay. So this is an alternative proof of reciprocity in resistive two port networks.